To bring all of that to us, we bring in our host of the Premier League on NBC, Rebecca Lowe from the West Coast, who's having a nice, calm, relaxing morning from what I can gather. Rebecca, good morning to you.
Mike Tirico, yeah, just to let the audience know, setting up a home studio, not so easy. I've already broken one paperweight and one snow globe. So other than being surrounded by broken glass, everything is fine this Tuesday morning, Mike.
That's you. Just head down, keep charging. That's why we love you. So, Rebecca, so this testing news that came from the Premier League, I thought this was interesting that we got this morning. Over 700 tested, 748 in terms of players and other staff. Six tested positive on three different clubs. What are we supposed to read into that and those numbers as they start this small-sided training for the Premier League clubs?
Well, Mike, as you say, the news has only just come out really in the last 20, 25 minutes or so. And the general consensus from what I can gather is that six out of 748 is actually about as positive news as you can get. Those six members of the clubs, whether they're players or playing staff, like you say, will now be isolated for the next 7 days. There'll be another round of testing later this week. The plan is to test the players and the staff members twice a week, every week, without, at the moment, any stopping on that. And right now, as you say, they're doing small group training, and they're voting next week, two other big votes next week. Next Tuesday, they're going to vote on whether they're going to do contact training. And next Thursday, there's the big, big vote on whether or not they want the season to finish. And if they vote no, because they need 14 votes to pass whatever they decide. If it's a no and they have fewer than 14 votes, then they have to decide how they're going to finish the season. So it's a major step forward today, isolating six members of staff and six players and allowing everybody else to get out there and play. Who knows, in a couple more days, there might be a few more positive tests. But you have to say, the more positive tests, the better. Get the players, get the members of staff isolated, let everybody else get back into the swing of things and try to move this Premier League season forward.
So you mentioned Thursday, and that's the date when, as you go down that right column there, with that big meeting needing the 14 of the 20 clubs to vote. So Rebecca, June 12th with a potential date for return. If you can remind us again, how much season is left? How long would it take to finish the season if the best case scenario holds up and they do restart on June 12th?
So June 12th at the moment is a very much a penciled in date, Mike. It might be pushed back to June 19th. It might even be pushed back to June 26th. It all, of course, depends on the testing, and it depends on how training goes and if there are any setbacks. In terms of how long of the season is left, there are 9 games roughly per team, around 7 weeks of action, we think. We think 7 weeks of weekend games with a couple of midweek fixture lists in there as well. So they need about a 7-week period overall to complete this season.
So what would that do, Rebecca, to that whole summer silly season when I'm over at the British Open the last 23, 24 years, the headlines are always dominated by some ridiculous number of millions of pounds being paid for this player, and the transfer window gets really hot in the summer. Given the strange scheduling and the economics now, the uncertainty on that end, what's going to happen just to the structure of global soccer, even if we do get back to play here in mid-June?
Unfortunately, Mike, there are no answers on that. UEFA, who are in charge of the transfer window that all the clubs in the European leagues abide by and stick by, June 1st is when the transfer window opens, and then the end of August is when it ends. So they have those 3 months, as you say, to spend those ridiculous amounts of money on different players. There's been no word about the transfer window. Now, of course, it's almost June 1st, and therefore the transfer window cannot open while the teams are still playing. I mean, that's what used to happen years ago, but that's long gone now. I can't imagine the transfer window is opening June 1st, although it hasn't actually been announced whether or not it will. Players' contracts are another problem. They're going to be allowed to be extended until the end of the end, till the end of the end of the end of the season, if you like, this new extended section of the season. But it is a complete and utter mess. The Bundesliga has already started. La Liga and Serie A in Italy and in Spain are trying to get back on. But the problem is, every team and every club and every league around Europe does need to all stick to the same schedule. But every country is dealing with coronavirus differently. And so that's very, very difficult. We are awaiting news from UEFA. 25th of May is when they want to hear from every European league as to how they're going to move forward. Perhaps after that date, the 25th of May, we'll know a little bit more about this transfer window, because like you say, it's a silly season, but it's a really important season for all the clubs to try and strengthen. It is a little bit of a mess right now with regards to transfers.
And of course, UEFA is the big umbrella with all the European soccer leagues, La Liga trying to get going here. Did you watch any of the German soccer, the Bundesliga, returning this past weekend with no fans? I sampled it briefly just to get a sense of what these behind closed doors games look and, most importantly, sound like. What was your sense as you sampled a little bit of that on Saturday morning?
I did, Mike. I did. I had to tune in. I'm missing my football so much. So I tuned in, of course. And, you know, yes, it was jarring. I switched on. I could hear the players shouting, the staff shouting. There was nothing else but that the whole way through. And it felt strange. But you know what? Halfway through watching, I started to get used to it. And I think the most important thing, and I think actually the Liverpool manager, Jurgen Klopp, said that this week. One of the most important things we have to remember about our game, football, is that I grew up playing it in my back garden with my brother, day in, day out. Nobody was watching me. Many of my friends, many of the players that you watch now on the big, big platform started out in a park. Nobody was watching them, maybe one man and his dog. That was it. People play soccer, play football for the beauty of the game, and it can stand alone. Of course, having 60,000 fans in the stadium creates an atmosphere, makes the whole thing even more beautiful and the whole thing even better. But football is strong enough to stand alone as a sport to be watched temporarily on a short-term basis behind closed doors. We know this won't be forever, and we know everybody's going to do everything they can to get those fans back in. But while we have to do it, it's not the worst thing in the world to sit and watch amazing players play a game they love, a game that we love, and we will wait for the fans when the time is ready. But I actually don't think, in fact, it's made me more excited, Mike, to try, fingers crossed, to bring the Premier League back to the fans on NBC some point in mid-June, because I know that ultimately the game itself, those players, those goals, the moves, everything about it is what people love so much.
All right, I got two quick ones. We only have a minute and a half. Who has been the favorite guest that you've had? Because you've spoken to almost everyone in the Premier League here along the way from your house. Who's been the one that you've enjoyed the most?
I would say it had to be Jurgen Klopp, the Liverpool manager. I mean, he is 25 points clear at the top of the league. First of all, you're talking to the man who's just become world champion, European champion, soon, hopefully at some point for his sake, to become Premier League champion. He is a special manager. But you know what? He's such a special man as well. No matter what comes out of his mouth, it's well thought out. It's intelligent. It's articulate. He is so fascinating to talk to. Quite honestly, talking to somebody like that was a real honour.
And lastly, are you going to mix an American breakfast into the whole Beck's breakfast deal that you've been doing on social media? We got it. Beans and toast. We understand that's a proper British breakfast. Can you throw some pancakes and eggs out there for us? You're American. You're in America long enough now, Rebecca.
Mike, the weird thing is about you guys is that if you want me to make an American breakfast, it's like, it's not breakfast, let's be honest, it's not breakfast, is it? It's pancakes, let's throw in some raspberries, some bacon, a little bit of egg with some melon. What is that all about? We're being sent so many pictures of breakfast. Honestly, I'm trying to educate one day at a time. Beans on toast was last week. Next week, Mike, I'm going to teach everybody to make the perfect cup of tea. Very important stuff. I'm doing very highbrow stuff here at home.
You heat up water and you put it in a tea bag. What is there to do?
Mike, you need to watch the video, all right? That's all I'm going to say.
Rebecca Lowe, not just homeschooling her young, adorable son, but teaching all of America about breakfast. She's only one woman, but she takes on the hopes of an entire country. Thank you, Rebecca. Have a good day. Talk to you soon.
Bye, Mike. You too.
Hi, I'm Mike Tirico, and thanks for watching. Make sure to hit subscribe for the latest news and highlights from NBC Sports.